Tonight, I am welcoming you to a very special edition of Winter with the Writers. As we close out this incredible 2017 season, I mean, it really has been a remarkable season, we are celebrating our continuing partnership with the National Book Foundation and its National Book Awards on Campus program. If you recall, last year was our inaugural event. Please join me in welcoming the new executive director of the National Book Foundation, Lisa Lucas. Would you mind standing? And we're very honored to have you join us this evening. Prior to joining the National Book Foundation, Ms. Lucas served as publisher of Guernica, a nonprofit online magazine, focusing on writing that explores the intersection of art and politics with an international and diverse focus. It's perfect for a liberal arts college. Ms. Lucas also has an extensive film and theater background, so we welcome you, and we hope you will recognize many kindred spirits here at Rollins. So in its 12th year, the National Book Award on Campus program connects the nation's most accomplished writers with students and faculty and scholars at select colleges across the United States. Each year, the program brings National Book Award finalists to campus to conduct master classes, to do readings of their works, and to have public discussions of their works. Last year, Rollins was honored to join Amherst, Concordia, and Sam Houston University to become the fourth NBA on-campus partner and the sole representative in the Southeast. We're very proud of that connection. So in many ways, Rollins is the perfect match for the NBA on-campus program. The National Book Foundation, founded in 1950, has as its mission to celebrate the best of American literature, to expand its audience, and to enhance the cultural value of great writing in America. These values are shared by Rollins College, shared by the Department of English, and certainly by our Winter with the Writers program, directed by Professor Carol Frost, herself a former National Book Award judge in the poetry category. Winter with the Writers is a festival of the literary arts that couples world-class writers with the college's creative environment and encourages the appreciation of literary excellence in our American culture. So, tonight we are honored to have two National Book Award finalists join us at Rollins. Their books were considered to be among the very best written in 2016, and you're going to get a chance to hear them read tonight. So to introduce the authors, it is my pleasure to welcome Professor Carol Frost, director of Winter with the Writers. And just a few short things. She wouldn't let me talk long about her at all. So just a few short things. Professor Frost holds the Theodore Bruce and Barbara Lawrence Alphon Chair of English. She's the author of 12 books of poems. And in 2015, Rollins awarded Professor Frost the Bornstein Award for Faculty Scholarship. This is our highest honor, and it recognizes a faculty member whose outstanding scholarly achievement or creative accomplishment has helped bring national prominence to Rollins College. So ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce the director of Winter with the Writers, Professor Carol Frost. Thank you.
Jenny, you said you wouldn't do that. Thanks. Dr. Kavanaugh, and welcome all of you. Welcome to back. I've recognized so many faces out there, so many people in our loyal audience, and some new faces too. That's great. The idea is to create the largest community we possibly can for all of the writers that we bring in. Many of you in the audience have helped us to welcome four other Winter with the Writers guests. And they were, those of you who don't know, they were Chris Abani, Susan Orlean, David Kirby, and Florida Poet Laureate Peter Menke. Tonight we feature Chris Bachelder and Jay Hopler, two 2016 National Book Award finalists, as Jenny told you. They'll read one after the other, having rolled dice at supper about who goes first and who last. And I'll tell you about them separately right before each one reads. And our first reader tonight will be poet Jay Hopler. Let me tell you a little bit more about the program. Jay will read, and then Chris Bachelder will read, and then we will break briefly to collect your questions. You all got 3x5 cards and pencils, probably at the door as you walked in. If not, then people can hand them out to you, and we'd like you to just write down any question you might have for either one or both of the writers. We'll do that Q&A session for about 20 to 25 minutes, and then we'll have a book signing. So I hope you enjoy the program. I can't see why you wouldn't with these amazing writers here. Thanks again. The poems in Jay Hopler's National Book Awards nominated book, The Abridged History of Rainfall, are fierce, elegiac. The judge's citation calls the book a quote, core sample of grief, unquote. The dead father fathers this grief. From the poet's sometime angry sorrow, where, quote, angels will, like murder birds, descend on us from heaven, our prayers still caught in their teeth, to the sometime solace he finds in the things of the world, sky, orange tree, light, and, quote, those parakeets, unquote, in the poem. He goes on to say, in beauty is a real thing, I've seen it. No, only those parakeets will do, and they will not do what I want them to do. In this, they are like everything else in the world, every beautiful thing. Grief and beauty don't behave any more than the weather, the dry thunder, and the rain. Much more can be said of the 31 poems in Jay Hopler's collection, and much more, I predict, will be said. That's what happens when poems are made well enough to last. I don't have to tell you how they are made, though I find it hard to resist this pleasure. I don't have to, because you will hear it for yourselves. Jay Hopler teaches over in Tampa. He is the author of another collection of poems, Green Squall, and the editor with a book that is available out in our foyer of an anthology of devotional verse, co-edited with Kimberly Johnson. It's called Before the Door of God, and as I said, an anthology of devotional poetry. He's the recipient of many awards, including the Yale Series of Younger Poets Award, the Great Lakes College, the Great Lakes College Association New Writers Award, a fellowship from the Lannan Foundation, the Whiting Writers Award, and the Rome Prize in Literature. He teaches in the writing program at the University of South Florida. As you know, he was also a National Book Award finalist. He's actually a pal of mine, and I hope that you will join me in warmly welcoming Jay Hopler.
Thank you all for coming tonight. I have so enjoyed my time here, getting to spend time with Carol and Lisa and Chris and all the great students. So I'm going to go first tonight because my book is depressing. So it's good to get that out of the way. And I might limit the inter-poem stuff because, well, there's not a whole lot of funny backstory to these poems, although there are a few, so I'll pop those in. Winter night full of stars. I am a winter night full of stars. I am that star, the one you thought was a plane. I am the shadow of that plane casting its blackness over the lake house, like a shroud. And I am that shroud, black, embroidered with stars, under which you grew cold that January night, laid out upon that catafalque of down. And those feathers were as snow in that mortuary air, floated like snowflakes in that mortuary air when the wind came up. And when the wind died down, they were as snow upon the ground. Am I the smoke drifting through the bare branches of a Japanese maple? Or am I the Japanese maple smoke drifting through its bare branches? It is not smoke, but light burning to a fine ash. And in that darkness, may you, like those dark blooms, shine. Come. Oh, let us to dust together. Those of you who are homeowners in the room, you'll recognize the title of this poem. Where is all this water coming from? Another dull, unrainy day. Not warm, not cool. A little wind, then none. My mother turns a light on and sits down on the sofa with a book. A blue jay lights for an instant on the back fence. Some clouds wisp by. Or is that smoke? Some smoke wisps by. Bright, though distant, the sound of gunfire or a car backfiring. On the air, the smell of wet wood burning. But that can't be. All day the clouds have rolled their grim lead westward and left us nothing. I wonder what she's reading. The unabridged history of rainfall. No, it's Gunter Eich, Botschaften des Regens. That book, when read by a widow in her marriage house, aloud and in the German, makes a man want to turn his eyes skyward and confide his despair to the migrating birds. If only there were migrating birds. I had occasion to live in Rome for a while, and when I arrived, I was overcome by how absolutely beautiful every human being was. And that sparked a poem. And my wife was not with me living in Rome at that point. She had to stay back because of work and the children. So I was very excited about the poem, and I Skyped her and I said, I have to read this to you. And then I learned that there are some poems that you shouldn't read to your spouse, especially when you are thousands of miles away. It is called, Oh, the Sadness Immaculate. The women in Rome are so beautiful, it's like being beaten to death in slow motion looking at them. It's like bleeding, so I don't look at them. I look at the parakeets nesting in the blood orange trees, the moon rising behind some ancient something or other, the first few stars. From my window, I can see the house where Galileo invented the telescope. I wonder what he was thinking that night he first searched heaven. I wonder what it was he was trying not to see. There was a beautiful church in the Piazza Navona, and I would go there in the afternoons and just sit and watch the sun set through the windows. And that's where this poem comes from. A moral victory is still a defeat. It was the 21st of January, and in Sant'Agnese in Agone, the light was not quite right. So late in January, it could have been a watery amber, dripping through those high dome windows. Instead, it was a smoldered orange, almost embered, and it rose from the floor in front of the altar, a kind of shimmer that made of Judy's Holy Family an inferior mirage. That rose someone left on the floor in front of the altar. Was that where the light was coming from? Was it coming from those candles burning on the altar? No, it was from the shrine that light came shining, from the skull of the saint herself. How dismal the winter that year, Rome steeped in a weak tea light, as though the world were trapped in amber. Oh, Agnes, it was. It was trapped in amber, that sorry world. Excerpts from the Unabridged History of Rainfall. So a little bit of a longer poem. And I will just say that there's a term in here, laying heavy leather. It's a fight term. It means to hit someone really hard. In dark rain and sharp rain, in this rain sharpened dark, in this dark sharpened by the sound of rain falling on the roof of the hospital, in blessed rain, in godless rain, in rain that lays its gray weight on the grass, in rain that passes through the branches of the aspen and the mountain ash, and of this drip-lit river makes a testament to heaven's lack of light. Your doctor with his every room a shadeless chandelierium, what is this dark but light unlamped to him? In the photograph, my father is running down Miami Beach, his feet kicking up fans of sand between the splayed legs of lithe, smiling University of Miami cheerleaders. The year is 1947. God has once again cast Satan from his heaven, and it is safe to turn one's face unto the sun. The palm fronds by sea breezes bent are black against the thunder-headed sky. The hull of every sailboat is white. At the edge of the beach, an empty bench, birds. After the German won. From the hedgerow, the call of the plover, as plaintive as it is strong. You think of St. Jerome. There is in this one voice such an intense loneliness, only a downpour could answer it. Forget about your bones. This wet gets in the soul, the spirit, whatever you want to call it, that pilot light we're all so proud of. It makes you wish its sad, dim flame would just hiss out. The waterlogged fronds of the tin palms dripping, the gate swinging, sodden on its hinge. After the German, too. Nothing will there be but rain. No roof and no dam will protect me from it. On the paths will be trampled springs green to muck. The gray sky collapsing like a lung. The thunder down its heavy leather lays, and from the ruined garden by the lake, a hazy murmuration lifts into the rain-lit air, blurs into the mists that swirl there, then settles in thin wing-swept breaths back into the maidenhair. After the German, 3. In the hospital, the suffering howl. The night's bluish plumage buzzes. The rain glittering thunders down upon the roofs. The streetlights have come on. Soon it will be dark enough to see them. Today it rained so hard, Father, you could hear it, life's shortness of breath. Now I'm going to lighten the mood a bit, which is not difficult since that couldn't get much darker. So I give my students assignments sometimes, but my policy is I never ask someone else to do something I cannot do myself. So before I gave them the assignment to write a found poem, I decided that I would go and try to write a found poem. So I found this wonderful, wonderful book in some old bookstore called, if I can find it, and I can't, The Ranges of Birds, a field guide to the birds east of the Rockies. So I went through this book and I found that the author had transcribed phonetically all the bird calls that he heard. And so I thought, well, there you go. Poem found. So this is my found poem called The Ranges of Birds. A simple spiritless purwee or chewee, a staccato tuck-a-tuck or cut-a-cut, also a single cuke A piercing creep or creep or loud pick pick pick. A low nasal work. Also tick tick tick. A hoarse car wit. When flushed, a cackle. A cackling cor ee ya, cor ee ya. An emphatic sneezy bark. Kiow, wow, or whoa. An asthmatic squeal. Keer, slurring downward. A slightly Phoebe-like p-p-p-pitzy or pitizy. A croaking cruck or bruck. A metallic talk. A harsh tseer. A whistled woo-wee. A musical too. Also a rattle and a whistle. Ticky-tick-too. A throaty rasping za-za-za. Also k-weck, k-weck. A nasal wide-awake or wacky-whack. A loud whistled whoop. Also a rolling prrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrr And that was just pure pleasure. I also love dogs, and I love John Berryman. So when I found the opportunity to marry dogs with John Berryman, I couldn't say no. So this is my imitation of one of Berryman's dream songs, and it's sort of my ode to dogs. I used to rescue abused hunting dogs, and my job was to rescue them and then rehabilitate them and adopt them out to forever homes. But I fell in love with them, and I couldn't let them go. So I had a whole house full of hunting dogs. Anyway, they're all dead now. So there's that story. Dogs. Dogs pass no laws against you, and knock not they your daughters up, and do not to Manhattan go with your last $200. So in general, dogs are a-okay with me. It's people should be neutered and kept off the grass. People and cats. People, like cats, are mean and always breeding and make your teeth hurt. Plus, they're sneaky. No dog caught dead would sneaking be, and anyone says otherwise is a doggone cat-loving liar. A dog can't tell a lie. A cat can't tell the truth. And people, at least the ones I've known, can't tell the difference. That's why I live alone. With my dogs. That, and because everyone else is gone. Oh, yeah, I kind of undercut that, didn't I? Boom. It's hard for me to tell a joke without, like, having a little at the end. So I was lucky enough to win a Whiting Award, and I went to New York to receive it. And I didn't know this, but part of the ceremony is the judges give you a book of poems by a poet that you remind them of. So all the writers were sort of nervous about getting their book, and mine was a Hart Crane. And I like Hart Crane, but he's also, to my mind, like the great American failure, who drank his talent away and then threw himself off a cruise ship and killed himself. So I was like, oh, that's a lovely gift. Thanks for that. Anyway, a student of mine introduced me to this poetic form called a glose, where you take four lines of a poem that exists, and then you put that at the top of the page, and then you do a four-line stanza, and for every line of the poem that you take. And so the first line of the poem that you take is the fourth line of your first stanza, and the second line of the poem is the last line of your second stanza, etc. So I thought, I'm going to exercise this Hart Crane demon in this glose. So I chose lines from his poem Postscript. Mine is a world foregone, though not yet ended, an imagined garden gray with sundered boughs and broken branches wistful and unmended, and mist that is more constant than all vows. And here is my glose. Aside from likewise being father fraught, and likewise fond of booze, and likewise not from mother in any way defended, And though I have said as you have said, mine is a world foregone, though not yet ended. And though we, those manias, their subsequent depressions share, and though it's true that I, like you, am given to a certain humid tropical carouse and fetishize, O Carib Isles lush, and though I, too, live in an imagined garden gray with sundered boughs, and am haunted by my history, the path I've through this blooming world cut, such brooders we, such splendid sufferers, two trees we are, with crooked trunks and broken branches, wistful and unmended. I am nothing like you, Mr. Crane. I will not fail. I will not fall like garbage from some ship's slick deck, its bow's great wake raking mare's manes from the spume and mist that is more constant than all vows. It should be said, though, he had one of the great suicide notes. Two words. See ya. That's style right there. My students hate the fact that, well, they hate when I tell them that what a poem means is the least interesting thing about a poem. And they always ask me when we're talking about Donne or Keats, well, what does that mean? And I wrote them this poem to answer that question. It is called, What This Poem Means. This poem means it thunders too much, nothing coming of it. This poem means it is the end of days, sunshine. We're all going to snuff it in the dark, and when we do, the angels will, like murder birds, descend on us from heaven, our prayers still caught in their teeth. This poem means whether you are loved or left, whether you love or leave, the only things that change are the names of your creditors. This poem means the bells of the ruined church in the corner are chiming the Cambridge quarters a little too slowly and a little too late. This poem means there are no pear trees in the monastery's anatomically correct apple orchard. This poem means I'm so miserable, my stars shine on Jesus. This poem means I burn like an exaggerated candle. This poem means the wind whops the shutters shut, the parakeets keening in the blood orange trees. I'll just read a couple more. I started to write in form for some reason in this book. I've never written in form in my life, but all of a sudden I began to turn out rondels and rondeaus and triolets and whatnot. So here's a rondeau. The pallbearer. Oh, wet black gleaming sequin factory, aka you starry night. What's with all the strobe bright ornament? This is a coffin, not some diva's palanquin I'm carrying. You get that, right? Oh, wet black gleaming sequin factory, aka you starry night. Can't you be like these banyans, ungrieving but seemly, polite? It's my father, for the love of Christ. The new moon is finally risen, a wet black gleaming sequin. And I did this long poem. It's in 13 sections, don't worry. I'll just do the first one and the last one. It's called The Rooster King. I used to live in Ybor City in Tampa, and I fell in love with the wild chickens that just roam the streets. And I sort of adopted a few unofficially and began to write poems to them, more than about them. I learned as I lived there that they were cockfighting chickens. So one day as I was working on this poem, I looked out and I saw some people kicking one to death, and it was one that I happened to like, although that wouldn't have mattered. I mean, it's an animal. So I ran out and chased them away and saved the bird and thought I'd done a good deed. A couple days later, I came home from teaching and they had found the bird, and they'd broken all the bones in its body but not killed it, and then put it on my on my front stoop. So I called the police, and they said, oh yeah, those guys, they run the cockfighting rings in Ybor City, and you should leave. So I broke my lease and left. And it's really funny, I took the bird to have it put to sleep at a vet, and they were like, why are you bringing us a chicken? It's a chicken. So apparently it's quite common. Anyway, so it's called the Rooster King, and it's somewhat about that, but there's also, you know, Christ and Peter and my father and everything else rolled up in here. So I'll just read the first section and the last, the coda. Section one, another gorgeous day in Florida. This afternoon makes me think I will die badly. One minute it's cloudy, the next the sun is so bright it's like having your brains pecked out. This afternoon makes me think I will die badly. Oak trees, tea roses, Spanish moss. A small hawk from the dogwood drops its shadow on the late June lawn. Blue baskets fat with red blooms flank the stone steps to the front porch. This afternoon makes me think I will die badly. I want to die badly, drunk and bloody, crying for my mother, pleading with God to save me. But this afternoon, I'm happy. Why shouldn't I be? I'm not some murdered bird, some chicken kicked to its pitiful death in a vacant lot. I'm not some waste of a perfectly lovely afternoon. A tea rose, is there anything more excruciating? This afternoon makes me think I will die badly. Is it the way the crepe myrtle catches the shadow of the hawk in the pink folds of its petal dress? Is it the way the lawn laps at the front steps, its rough mane lashing? A breeze moves through. Church bells ring the quarter hour. On the ends of thick green stems, the hips of breeze-blown roses float, exhausted, spent as wrecked comets. This afternoon makes me think I will die badly. Please, God, let it happen. A palm rat scratches in the lavender. A wild rooster cocks his throat and crows. And I will finish with this poem. I went to visit Louise Glick several years ago, and she was having a wasp problem. And there was this huge wasp's nest on her porch, and we were standing inside watching the people kill them. And for some reason, I don't know, it's just said, hey, you know, those nests are called vespiaries. And she said, I'll be darned. You should put that in a poem. So I did. The Coast Road. And thank you again for having me and for coming. It's been a wonderful experience. The Coast Road. On nights like these, when the house is too quiet, I walk into the moonlit yard and listen. The wind in the oak tree says nothing ever happens when you want it to. The crickets in the witchgrass say there will never be an end to this droning of the surf. No end to this drowning of the surfer. The tired tread of traffic in the distance. It's not what one listens to that matters, but what one listens for. From the rafters of the back porch, the remnants of a vespiary are hanging, its gray walls stripped thin by poison and last night's rain. A bird takes flight, the moon ignites, the evening weeps its traffic lights. Isn't there a bird somewhere whose call sounds like, I'm sorry, I'm sorry? What silence is there deep enough to follow a cry like that? Thanks.
With poems like that, Jay Hopler, you will die well. I hadn't read Chris Bachelder before. There, I did it, Chris. I hadn't read Chris Bachelder before I read his National Book Award-nominated novel, The Throwback Special. and I almost didn't read him then either. Read a book about a group of men that convenes each November to reenact the play in which Washington Redskins quarterback Joe Theismann suffers his gruesome leg injury? Football fan that I am, still, I remember feeling pretty much the same way his 10-year-old daughter did when she asked her dad if the premise of the book or the situation wasn't mean. He told her, "It's not mean, honey. It's hard to explain. But trust me that what these men do is not mean. It's sort of the opposite." That's what I found. The men Chris Bachelder portrays, men in a group of men, maybe flawed, who isn't, but they yearn to be better men, somehow more masculine, yes, but also better friends, better fathers. Readers end up liking the men, not so much because they are heroic or even especially likable, but because they remind us of the men in our living rooms, eating guacamole, drinking beer, and watching the big game. Actual men. Then there's Bachelder's writing, his empathy and wit. The book is in places simply hilarious. And his skill at characterization. Heaven sakes alive, just wait till you hear. Chris Bachelder, Chris Bachelder is the author of the novels Bear vs. Shaq, US 1, Abbott Awaits, and most recently, Throwback Special. The Paris, he has won, I've gotten to the point where I can't see. Does anyone have glasses? Maybe I can borrow? All right. His novels have been translated into 5 languages, and his short fiction and essays have appeared in the Paris Review, The Believer, McSweeney's, the New York Times, Hopper's, the Oxford American, the Massachusetts Review, Subtropics, and other magazines and anthologies. He received his MFA just up the road at the University of Florida, and he has taught fiction writing at New Mexico State, Colorado College, and he teaches now at the University of Cincinnati. He lives in Cincinnati with his wife and 2 daughters. And as far as I know, he did not play football. Chris Bachelder.
Thanks, Carol, so much. It's really a joy to be here, and thanks to Dean Kavanaugh, and great to see Lisa Lucas again. Wonderful honor to read with Jay. His poems, I just think, are astonishing. This has just been a really pleasant and well-run and well-organized event, and I'm so happy to be here, and a special thanks to the students. I've really enjoyed meeting and working with you as well. I did play football as a young person, but there was this weight limit. They weighed the kids. I was kind of a big kid. And if you were over a certain weight limit, they put a black X in electrical tape on your helmet, and you had to play the line. You couldn't play a skill position. So that was pretty scarring to have a black X on my helmet and not be able to touch the ball ever. But I'm glad now that I didn't continue to play and suffer brain injuries. Jay's book's about grief and sorrow and bewilderment, and he smuggles in humor and wit in really wonderful ways, and I think my novel's a comic novel, and I try to smuggle in grief, sorrow, and bewilderment. So they're sort of mirror images. So these guys get together every year in November in a kind of crummy American hotel, and they think they're there for the football reenactment, but they're really there for something else, some sort of ritual or intimacy or connection of some kind. They have all these rituals and rites, and then they have a lottery to determine who plays who, and they have pizza and beer, and then the things that they retreat to hotel rooms by position. So all the receivers go to a hotel room, and all the defensive backs, and there's a kind of the night kind of becomes slower and quieter. And I'm going to read a few episodes from the section where they're all heading toward bed in their separate rooms. Chad walked along the fourth floor hallway. He had no shadow and his feet made no sound as he walked. The hotel had transformed his sense of scale and reference. Chad had ceased being a discrete unit of biological meaning. It felt okay. The sound from room 414 may or may not have been a cat. It was not yet late, but many guests had already hung their lewd, do not disturb signs from their door handles. Chad thought of them as do not disturb signs, though in fact they did not say do not disturb. There were no words on the signs at all. At some point in the history of hospitality, it occurred to Chad, the do not disturb sign had become symbolic, metaphorical. These signs on the fourth floor featured a sprig of bamboo leaning lasciviously against a lurid stack of polished wellness stones. Moving noiselessly through the hall, imagining the varieties of intercourse to his port and starboard, Chad collected the signs from the door handles as he passed. In an attempt to avoid Andy and Nate, Chad stepped into an elevator containing Andy and Nate. "We were just looking for you," Andy said. "Me too," Chad said as the doors closed. The men were quiet as the elevator dropped slowly toward the lobby. Andy took a long, slow drink from his red cup. Nate stared at the illuminated number above the doors, confirming their descent. Chad looked down at the shoes his wife disliked so forcefully. His wife's contempt for the shoes was, in fact, their primary feature, more salient than their color, style, material, or comfort. He could not even see the shoes anymore. He could only see that face that she made. The shoes were haunted. Why did she insist on expressing her disdain for these shoes? Or, put another way, why did he continue to wear them? On the floor was a sticky note that read, 45 days. Chad felt trapped. The elevator stopped on the first floor and the men got out. Standing on the floral carpet, Chad suffered that fleeting, vertiginous wobble that health experts in an internet anxiety forum had diagnosed as either multiple sclerosis or nothing to worry about at all. Without speaking or conferring in any way, the men turned and walked down the hallway toward the side exit of the hotel, and it seemed to each man that their pace slowed as they neared the door. Outside the exit, there was a picnic table next to a dumpster, and it was there that these three men traditionally convened for a post-lottery smoke. During the year, however, Chad had quit smoking, and he had yet to tell Nate and Andy. He did not know Nate and Andy well. He saw them once a year, and these nighttime smokes by the hotel dumpster were the sole basis of their friendship. They had created sub-tradition, sub-community. Chad had not quite articulated this to himself, but he felt that it would be inhospitable not to smoke at the picnic table with Andy and Nate. It would perhaps be construed as a renunciation or as a claim of superiority or judgment. Because he saw them only one weekend per year, it might seem to them that the reason he had quit smoking was that he no longer desired their friendship, when in fact there had been other reasons that he had quit smoking cigarettes. He did not want the other men to think that he did not value their company, though in truth he valued their company only very slightly. Nate also had quit smoking 9 months ago, but was reluctant, obviously, to tell Chad and Andy. For Nate, there was something distasteful, almost shameful, in quitting. Doctors and school children and righteous billboards were always exhorting him to quit, and even though they were right, Nate found repugnant the notion that he must capitulate. It made him feel like a child, and he hated being made to feel like a child, though he supposed that Charles would say that nobody can make you feel anything. He had wanted to quit, of course, but to quit was to obey, and he did not want to admit to annual smoking friends that he had surrendered. Andy had also quit smoking during the year, but he simply could not find a way to tell Chad and Nate. Andy had quit smoking numerous times in the past. In fact, a year ago when they had smoked beside the dumpster, Andy had not previously smoked in 6 months, and he had become sheepish about the very attempt to quit. He was reluctant to tell the other two because he did not want to see the knowing smirks, the nods, the raised eyebrows of men who very well knew he could never really quit. The three men moved toward the exit door with lassitude and dread. They might never reach the door. A desk clerk watching the men on closed-circuit television might have thought they were demonstrating one of the paradoxes of motion, though the desk clerk was not watching the monitor but instead reading Ayn Rand's The Fountainhead. Each man, it is true, was also beginning to crave a cigarette. Outside, the rain still fell, not hard but insistent and at cruel angles. Chad's shoes became heavy and wet, but even with these new qualities, they were still primarily the shoes that his wife disliked. The shoes had become a host for parasitic scorn. The three men stood hunched by the picnic table in November. Beside them was the dumpster brimming with sodden cardboard. Only cigarettes, only their glowing orange tips, could give meaning or coherence to this scene, and yet none of the men carried cigarettes. Thinking quickly, which is to say without thinking at all, Chad bent down to unlace his shoes. the linebacker room they call the fracture compound. That's where Lawrence Taylor, he's the one who sacked Theismann and broke his leg, so they call the linebacker room the fracture compound. And the guy in the lottery who gets the first pick and picks Lawrence Taylor, that's a sort of a complicated thing to do, to want to be Lawrence Taylor. In the fracture compound, Gary, Bald Michael, and George, there's two Michaels. There's Bald Michael, who's really bald, and Fat Michael, who's remarkably fit, but they just call him Fat Michael to make fun of him. Sort of a masculine joke that sprays hostility and insecurity indiscriminately. But Bald Michael is really bald, so it's not ironic, but it's still unkind. In the fracture compound, Gary, Bald Michael, and George sat on beds passing George's flask of homemade liquor. Bald Michael, grimacing and shuddering at the aftertaste, handed the flask to Gary, who grimaced and shuddered while drinking. George grimaced and shuddered in anticipation of his next drink. The small flask, which seemed never to become empty, had been a gift to George from his Wiccan co-worker at the public library. Gary wore Lawrence Taylor's two white wristbands so bright that they revealed other allegedly white objects, the men's teeth and eyes, their stretched V-neck t-shirts, the pillowcases, to be yellow or gray. The ring finger and middle finger of Gary's left hand were taped together, though not in historically accurate fashion. He dropped from the bed to the floor and performed 19 push-ups. When finished, he lay on the floor breathing. There were people who could do 100 push-ups. He wished he could lose 15 pounds. He thought of Fat Michael, that vein in his arm. It would not be satisfying to destroy ceremonially Fat Michael's leg, Fat Michael's playing Theismann. With his ear pressed to the carpet, Gary thought he could hear the subterranean rumbling of the hotel's complex machinery, but he knew that didn't make sense because he was on the fifth floor. He was in a box inside a bigger box. The carpet was redolent of nothing at all. Granted one wish, Gary had chosen invincibility. It was often the case that the men who chose Lawrence Taylor experienced a post-lottery affective crash that left them anxious, listless, disappointed, and sad. And something else, perhaps frightened or preemptively guilt-ridden. Bald Michael was talking about air quality again. "Hey man," George said to Gary, "you okay?" Gary tried to nod, but the flesh of his cheek against the hotel carpet had a relatively high coefficient of static friction, and his head barely moved. "Hey," George said, "you want me to walk on your back?" "No," Gary said quickly, though George was already peeling off his black socks. Nate, the fourth linebacker, entered the room. He was not wearing shoes. "Hey, Nate," George said, "can you turn off that light?" "Yeah, that one." Nate turned off the light. "And can you put that jersey over the bedside lamp?" Nate laughed, though he did not know why. He draped Bald Michael's Gary Reason's jersey over the lamp, and the room grew dim and blue. George unzipped his duffel bag and selected a CD. He looked around the room, then inserted the CD into Gary's laptop on the orange chair. George said, "Hey, George, I don't think..." But the first track on the Mountain Dulcimer compilation was Wildwood Flower, and he found that he could not complete his objection. "Wait until you hear Shady Grove," George said. "Gary, you're going to want to lift your shirt up." With his face still on the carpet, Gary lifted his shirt up. "Okay, Gary," George said. "You ready?" Gary did not respond, and George approached with his pant legs rolled. Gary stared at George's feet, which were coarse and clean and dry, with high arches, long and hairless toes, and toenails that appeared to be trimmed but not fussily managed. The feet were not tender and pale, helpless in the way of baby animals, but neither were they the hairy, black-soled, thick-nailed feet of a wandering hippie. If they had a smell, it was faint and mild and organic, like a cucumber. They were good feet, expressive of proper values. Observing no overt sign of resistance, George stepped onto the middle of Gary's back. Gary grunted, winced, squeezed his eyes shut. George stood still for a moment, achieving his balance, allowing Gary to grow accustomed to the weight. "There you go. There you go," George said. "That's it. Arms straight out. Now find your breath. Find it." Gary tried to find his breath, and gradually he found it. The dulcimer played Black Mountain Rag. And George began slowly to shift his weight from one foot to the other. In his cold, wet socks, Nate watched, wincing in sympathy with Gary. He could feel George's feet on his own back. He could feel a shortness of breath. Bald Michael took several pictures of George and Gary with his phone. Eventually, George began to shuffle deliberately up and down Gary's back. His balance was excellent. "How's that?" George said. Gary grunted and tried to nod. "Seriously," George said. "Feels like I'm standing on a coil of rope, man." With a librarian on his back, with a dulcimer music in the air, with the cold rain still tapping the window, with the heavy mantle of Lawrence Taylor upon his shoulders, Gary had the rare opportunity to break down entirely. He felt he could really lose it, and he was startled by the energy it took to resist it. "How did you know?" Gary said. "About your back?" Gary tried to nod. "Man," George said, "it's everyone's back that hurts." Nate was hoping he would be next, though he could not bring himself to ask. The dulcimer played Whiskey Before Breakfast. In the dim blue light, Bald Michael looked through the photographs he had taken, deleting each one for its failure to portray. This guy is Jeff. This is a little monologue from Jeff, who's a blowhard, and I've entered this monologue thinking Jeff's a blowhard, and then he started making some sense on me. That's what happens. You give people enough room, they start talking, and uh-oh. Jeff had a theory about marriage. "All it is," he said, and he said he learned this too late, "but all it is watching someone and having someone watch you." He paced in front of the mute television on which a pickup truck drove over boulders in slow motion. He sounded exasperated, as if the other eligible receivers in room 440, Randy, Steven, and Derek, had worn him down, forced him to defend his position, though in fact no one had asked him anything, and no one had been speaking about marriage. No one had been speaking much at all. "That's all it is," he said. He said, "when you're a kid, your parents watch your life. They know what's going on. They're watching you pretty carefully, or let's at least hope they are. They know you have a spelling quiz or a baseball game. They keep track of it all, and so you get the idea that your life is important, valuable. But then you grow up," Jeff said, "and it turns out nobody is really watching anymore. It would be weird if your parents knew that you switched cereals in the morning, or that the power went out at your office for 2 hours. Nobody really knows what your days are like." Jeff said he wasn't talking about the big things, moving to a new city or having a kid or losing your job. He said he was talking about the tiny, stupid crap that fills most of our days and that you can't tell people about because it's too small and stupid. "But it's your life," Jeff said, "right? It doesn't matter to anyone else," he said, "but it matters to you because it's your life. The water in your basement, the strange smell in your shower drain, changing your kids' bed sheets in the middle of the night." Jeff said that life is a precious gift, sure. "But usually what life is going to the store to buy a stupid piece of hardware and then buying the wrong size and then having to go back to get the right damn size, except the store doesn't have it." "If you're not married," Jeff said, "chances are nobody sees you make 2 trips to the store on Saturday morning for that thing, for that hinge or flange that you don't even get." Marriage, Jeff saw it so clearly now. What marriage does is at least guarantee that one person is watching. There's one person who knows you got the oil change today, or that you waited over an hour for your dentist appointment, or that you're trying a new shave gel, or that the running shoes you've worn for years got discontinued. On television, an adopted child was reunited with her birth mother, but none of the men saw it. "And here's the thing," Jeff said, "the wife does not have to care about any of this stuff." "It would be weird if she did," Jeff said, "right? Because it's boring," he said. "And because she has her own tiny crap that she's got going on in her life, and that seems important to her, and you're watching that for her," Jeff said. "See, you don't have to care," he said. "You just have to watch. You just have to be sentient, a witness. You don't even have to watch very carefully. You're not a scientist. You're not some astronomer." "It's not like that," Jeff said. "It's certainly not about keen perception, and it's not about gratitude or sympathy or even appreciation. It really is not about giving or getting credit. Just," Jeff said, "just trying to keep the squirrels out of the mulch. If that person who is watching happens to love you or respect you, or if that person concedes to have oral sex with you, that's a bonus," Jeff said. "But it's not necessary. It's not what marriage is for. It's just vital to have someone who sees your life. It's no small thing. And look," Jeff said to the men, "if you want any more from marriage than that, you'll be disappointed." He walked to the door, squinted into the peephole. "If you want to be connected," Jeff said, "or if you want to share a passion, or if you're thinking at all in terms of big old trees with thick roots, you're going to end up on the couch. First the couch," he said, "then a crappy studio apartment. The only thing marriage can really give you is a sense that your life is witnessed by another person, a kind of validation," Jeff said. "That's it," he said, "and it's plenty. If you have that, you have a lot. You have everything. But here's the thing," Jeff said, "people don't like being watched. They resent it." Jeff said that he resented it. He said that he wanted to be free from it. He wanted his wife to mind her own business. But when he got away from it, when his wife was no longer watching, he didn't feel free. He said he didn't feel relieved or liberated. He didn't. He said now he just feels like there's suddenly no point at all to buying the wrong kind of caulk for the window. You're not in a movie, Jeff said. He said that over and over. Nobody sees you, he said. He said that's why people pretend they're in movies. People say they want privacy, but they would actually like a camera out in their cold backyard at midnight, pointed through the kitchen window while they make a school lunch for their kids. They all want someone to just notice, Jeff said. He said that's what marriage is for. Otherwise, he said, honest to God, we're all just like penguins at the North Pole doing it all for no real reason. It turns out the men in that room weren't listening to him at all. They ignored his big speech. All right, I'll read this last section. It returns to Chad. He was in the smoking group, and we left him by the dumpster, unlacing his shoes. Adam stood looking out the window of room 212 like a homesteader during an April blizzard. The defensive backs, and particularly the safeties, were the least prominent of the reenactors. They backpedaled from tragedy like inverse first responders. Their job was essential but remote and untelevised. This feeling of being important but unrecognized, distant from the hub, was all too familiar to most of the men. The long-standing notion was that the defensive backs room was the party room. Vegas, it was called. But the truth was that the room typically had a sour mood and an early bedtime. If you work in the automotive industry, you have to be thinking about the end of cars, Adam said, still facing the window. If you work in phones, you have to be preparing for the day when people don't use phones anymore. If you work in laptops, you spend your days imagining what comes after laptops. Everything thriving is dying. Every industry has become the fashion industry. The car is dead. The book is dead. Sorry, Lisa. Sorry to the National Book Foundation. whom I'm tremendously grateful to, by the way. The car is dead, the book is dead, the PC is dead, my office is paperless, potatoes are somehow bad for you, people don't want to live in houses anymore, it's exhausting. Why were you so late, Adam? Peter said. It was a domestic situation, Adam said. What isn't? Peter said. It was a family emergency, Adam said. You got that right, Peter said. The heating and cooling unit ticked and clanked. Chad sat in the orange chair looking at his phone. His feet and socks were wet and cold. He felt that the cold, wet socks were emblematic of his folly and weakness. His throat burned from the cigarette he had bummed off that gray-faced marketer from Prestige Vista Solutions. He wished he had not smoked that cigarette, and it had been foolish to throw his shoes in the dumpster, he now realized. The only other shoes he had were his cleats. At the time he had thrown his shoes in the dumpster, he had felt a rush of defiance, but whom exactly had he defied? He liked the shoes, or had at one time, and so he had apparently defied only himself. He had spited his face. He had hoisted himself. His wife hated the shoes, and though she had not demanded or even suggested that he discard the shoes, in discarding them he was, he now felt, executing remotely her unspoken wish. That the actualization of his wife's desire had felt out in the rain by the hotel dumpster, so authentically like the actualization of his own desire, meant either that they were soulmates or that he lived under a totalitarian regime. How was it that he could not, here in his cold, wet socks, make any meaningful distinction between compliance and defiance, or ascertain to whom he had stuck it, if indeed he had stuck it to someone? It was true, however, that his wife was frugal, and she would no doubt object to his throwing away perfectly functional, though detestable, shoes. And so in this way, perhaps the act was defiant in its profligacy, like the Boston Tea Party. He would teach her a lesson. He would show her not to like his things. But that was not what he wanted. He wanted her to like his things, which meant inevitably that she would not like some things. He cared about what she thought. If your defiance reveals vulnerability, not strength, it's really not very effective defiance. Chad's original embarrassment about buying the shoes was now compounded by the embarrassment about throwing them away. He had acted like a maniac, and now he wanted his shoes. A genuinely defiant act, he realized, would be to retrieve the shoes from the wet dumpster. That would be a bold expression of his life force. He could dry them with the hair dryer attached to the wall in the hotel bathroom. But what about Andy and Nate? They had thrown their shoes in the dumpster, too. In a spirit of inebriated and defiant camaraderie, and as an expression of their individual wills, they had all thrown their shoes away together instead of smoking a cigarette, but then the guy from Prestige Vista Solutions shuffled out of the side exit with a full pack, and they all had smoked a cigarette even though they had all quit. Chad hated himself. If he pulled his shoes out of the dumpster, Nate and Andy would no doubt see the shoes tomorrow, and they would consider their recovery a sign of weakness, not strength. A kind of capitulation to the overwhelming forces of convention, a disavowal of their defiant ritual in the rain. Chad was trapped between two incommensurable systems of meaning. Sifting through the cold and soaking trash of the hotel dumpster would be both noble and craven, depending upon the interpretive community. "Fun here," Chad texted to his wife. "Love you." Charles, who was either a psychologist or a psychiatrist, was here in this room, and perhaps he could be of help to Chad, but he was at the moment occupied by Peter, who was troubled by a recent incident in his home. Chad waited in his wet socks, and the waiting felt emblematic. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
That was great, you guys.
Thank you.
I mean, you should take it on the road, you two. I mean, yeah. worked very well together and loved hearing. Did you know that there are no penguins up the North? So, are we set? Any more questions? Now, some of these are questions, and sometimes there are comments. And the first question is a comment. This comment may sound rude at first, but it will elicit a good story, I've been told. There are no penguins at the North Pole.
Now, nobody knows this more than I do at this moment, because so I wrote it wrong for Norton for the book, and then the book was serialized in the Paris Review, and the Paris Review is really stringent with their editing, and they said there's no, they wrote to me and said there's no penguins at the North Pole. But they said, I like this. She said, but what, we just had a long discussion in the office about where the joke lies. So I like the thought of these editors sitting around thinking about penguins in the North Pole and thinking about where the joke lies. And it gave me a chance to say, yeah, that was where the joke lay. You know, didn't you get it? So, you know, Jeff is a blowhard. And I had in mind, if you've ever seen that, what's it called, the penguin movie on the North, on the South Pole, obviously. March of the Penguins, which I found incredibly moving and sort of cosmically unsettling that these penguins are doing this without, I mean, we're watching because they filmed it, but otherwise, it's just happening. And why are they doing this? It's just so remarkably hard to make more penguins. So hard. So strenuous. And So it was Jeff. It was a good fitting ending to Jeff's story about penguins. So the joke was actually, you know, the March of the Penguins joke, and not necessarily that he messed up North and South Pole. So we changed it for the Paris Review. So historians, literary historians, will look back at this with amazement that it was published in the Paris Review as South Pole, and then in Norton, the book I read from it, we kept it the North Pole. So I had it both ways.
Following in the same tone, Jay, do you have a rule where you have to mention a bird in every poem? What is wrong with you people?
For this book, almost. One of the many titles that this book went through was Birds Are How the Earth Makes Sense of Heaven, and there were a lot of bird poems. But in the next book, no birds will appear.
You've used your quota.
I've used my quota, yes. Right. Birds and rain and dark skies. I think I'm done with that.
Okay, so do you find it difficult? I think this could be for either of you. It's not a side. Do you find it difficult to balance the humor with the darker moments in your work? Or do you find it difficult to balance the darker moments in your work with humor?
I'd be interested to hear what Jay says, because those poems, as weird as it is to say, but those poems are funny in their moments. And not just you and the banter, but the poems have real wit. But obviously our balance is different. I just feel like fundamentally I'm going to be a comic writer, and it's changed since my early books were sort of broad satire. And I guess I've just tried to make it more and more complicated. And I'm most interested in a kind of alloy, a tonal alloy that has humor. But you know, Vonnegut said this well, and a lot of people have said it well, that humor is often the flip side of, you know, frustration or grief or sorrow. And so I'm just interested in those alloys, those emotional alloys. We don't have good ways of talking about feelings. I mean, we say sad or happy, but how often are we just sad or just happy, right? It's usually the 15% this, 30% little bitterness, little envy, little joy, right, all mixed together. I'm most interested in primarily in a sort of comic approach, but I really wanted to use it to have readers get their guard down and then try to hit them with something more.
Cool. Yeah. Okay.
This is going to sound bad, but I find grief really, really funny. my own. I mean, not other people's. That would be bad. But I do find my own very, very humorous. I don't know why that is, but I guess that's why I am so attracted to Serbian poetry, because they have such a dark sense of humor. It's really a gallows humor that I enjoy. And writing about my father, he was a practical joker and just a hilarious man. And I just kept thinking, like, how hilarious he would have found the whole enterprise of me writing a book about his passing. He would have had a good time with that, I think.
So this is for you, Chris. You have said you can't judge your characters. How do you keep from judging the antagonist, the bad guy?
Yeah, I'm trying to think if this book has one other than mortality.
Right.
Time. I think it's important to just enter deeply into, if anybody walks on stage, enter deeply into that person and have them be complicated and not... Chekhov has this great letter. People said to him, he wrote a story about horse thieves, and somebody wrote to him, he made people really uncomfortable in Russia in the 19th century. Somebody wrote to him and said, your story is technically good, but you didn't say anything bad about horse thieves, you know? Chekhov has a great letter and just says, it's not my job, you know, to be the judge and the jury. Like, people, readers know stealing horses is bad. You know, I have other things to do and not much space to do it. And my job is to get the horse thieves correct, right? Well, how do they talk? What do they wear? What do they look like? You know, what are their days like? That's great. So yeah, it frees you in a way to not be a judge of your characters. I think that's a really important lesson to learn when you're writing, that it's just not your job. Just take everybody seriously, even bad people, whatever that is.
For Jay, did you almost get beaten after reading the Rome poem to your wife?
It was a good thing that I was in Rome and she was in Salt Lake City. That was good. I did get a long and icy stare until it dawned on me, like, oh, that's not an appropriate poem to have read at that moment.
This is a companion question for you. I mean, it's right underneath, so by juxtaposition, a companion question. The largest number of dogs you had at one time.
Oh, wow. Six, I think. Six big coon hounds.
Who are probably not, like, mentally well.
No, right? No. I had one, the poor thing, she was really gone. She didn't like snow, and I adopted her in Indiana. And whenever I would take her out, you know, to go for a walk, and I had like six dogs on leashes, and they would all be doing their thing. And I would look over, and there would be this one, like, standing on her back feet next to me, like it was like an alien, like, companion, because she didn't want to get her feet in the snow. So. But they were fun, and they would howl, like, in the middle of the night for no reason at all. I had the greatest wife in the whole world, but we have no pets now, so.
Can you describe the experience of creating and keeping organized so many individual characters in a single book?
Yeah, that was, like 4 seconds after I thought, I know, I'll have 22 guys. The honeymoon was quick, because then I thought, oh no, you know, that's a problem. it's a technical problem, and it produces, you know, the problem, writing books are solving problems. I think that's like, you don't solve problems as you write, that solving problems is actually the book itself. And so that created a point of view. Having to do that created a point of view, right? That problem creates a point of view that's sort of anthropological and wide-ranging and omniscient. And so once I created that point of view, that could take everybody in. And I just wanted to signal to readers that you don't have to keep track of everybody. You know, it's this chorus, it's this group. And people who need a protagonist or really want one are unhappy.
Did you write the book from beginning to end, or did you move parts around?
It was pretty, even though it's so episodic, mm-hmm. it was pretty chronological. There was some shuffling.
What about you, Jay, when you put this book together? Did you have a sense when you began where you wanted the book to go? And then at what point did you decide that you would organize it the way you did?
I had no idea where the book was going. Mm-hmm. I try to have no idea where my poems are going for as long as I possibly can maintain that. Because as soon as I know what I'm trying to say, I lose interest in it. And if I discover that too quickly, then I have a hard time getting over the finish line. I just kept writing, and then one day the poems that I was writing had a different voice. So I knew that I'd stopped something and started something else, and then I knew it was time to go back and order it. And that for me is the least enjoyable part of putting a book together, trying to find a good order.
How long does it take to write a novel? I think both of you should answer that.
Yeah.
That might be funny.
Yeah. So if I said 5 years, that would be right. And if I said a year, it would be right as well. It's really hard to, there was 5, 6, maybe 7 years of thinking a little bit about the Theismann injury and thinking there was something literary there that I wanted to explore. But I wasn't writing that whole time. And so there were a lot of false starts. But then once I figured it out, then it was probably a year of pretty intense. It's a short novel.
So it's really personal, isn't it? The answer is personal, isn't it?
It's not, yes. Yeah. It's not like it takes 3.5 years for everybody.
Okay, Jay, what advice would you give to someone who would like to cultivate an appreciation for poetry?
Well, read poetry. That's the biggest thing. But read, how to put this, read poetry that you like. I remember when I was in high school, I was introduced to Longfellow, and I remember hating Longfellow, and I remember thinking, wow, poetry sucks. And then, of course, I started to read around and discovered that he wasn't the only poet in existence, and there is literally a poet for every taste. So if you don't like the first book of poems you read, just keep looking, and I guarantee you will find something to your taste.
Yeah, Lisa, you were saying that yesterday, too, she was giving everyone permission to put down a book that they are reading that they don't like. And that's pretty much what you're saying, too,
yeah.
Isn't it? Yeah. What provoked the book beyond having seen the play?
I mean, that was the biggest thing. I was 14 and I watched it. I saw it on Monday Night Football. It was the second quarter. I was allowed to stay up till halftime, you know, so if it happened in the third quarter, I wouldn't have seen it. But I saw it, stayed with me. You can't unsee it if any of you have ever seen it. It's terrible. And then, I don't know, just, 6-7 years ago, I just started thinking about the play and like I said, thinking something's literary there and trusting myself, but not knowing what it was. It turned out that it wasn't the play itself. It was the play plus time, or the play plus a mind. Thinking about it, the play plus a middle-aged mind thinking about it, and that there was the warmth of nostalgia and the coldness of the brutality and the violence, and I was interested in that kind of tonal weather system where that coldness and the warmth met up. And then I think I watched the play so many times that the men began to seem like reenactors. I think that's what happened. I watched it so many times. Slow motion. I thought, wow, they're really good at that. I mean, they break his leg every time perfectly. 22 guys. And then once I made that leap, then I thought, oh yeah, it's it. It's not the play. I mean, I'm always wrong about what I think my books are about. And it's a good thing, because what I think they're about is not as interesting as hopefully what.
Good. So for Jay, there are a couple of questions here that are the same question, and it's about your religious worldview. One question goes, how does your faith that you confront in your poems play a role in your life? And the other is, would you mind sharing that with us?
How's my faith? That's interesting. That's complicated. My wife calls me a Hindu Presbyterianist. At this time. So that'll give you an idea of my religious worldview. I'm trying to think of a quick way to answer this question. The faith that I have certainly does play a huge role in my in the poems. For many years, I actually thought of writing poetry as a form of prayer. And I guess I still do, actually, in a way. There are other ways to pray now that I realize, but it's still that for me. The weird thing is that my conception of God is comes from so many different places. I mean, I was born into a very liberal, Unitarian kind of family that was very accepting. And so, of course, I went immediately to Jonathan Edwards' Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God as a child, and I thought, wow, these Puritans were awesome. So, you know, I was really attracted to the fire and brimstone, which I think freaked my parents out completely. And then in the last, I don't know, five years, I guess, I've become an Ashtangi, and it's a form of yoga, and so there's the Hinduism that is behind that, and so now I've immersed myself in the Upanishads and the Gita and the Yoga Sutras, so all the Eastern stuff is coming in now, and the new book I think is going to have those fingerprints all over it too.
Do you have a favorite character in this latest novel?
Well, Robert's a sort of sad sack, really anxious guy. I have a soft spot for him, and then George, the librarian, who walks on backs and gives people back rubs, and they don't really want him, but
no, that's funny.
But it,
George is, nobody's happy to see George come, but then he ends up sort of insinuating himself in a positive way. So I like George.
Do you have a favorite poem in this latest book?
Yeah, the last one that I read. I like that one a lot. I like that one a lot because of how it happened. I wrote the first three lines, and then like 10 years went by. And then I was in a hotel room, and all of a sudden the rest of the poem came. And that was a lovely feeling. It doesn't happen very often. I usually sweat over every word. That's probably why I like it.
It doesn't really, it's not a resolution. You wouldn't call it that, would you, or would you?
No. Yeah, I don't have many of those.
Yeah. That's one of the things that I like so much about it, because it doesn't really resolve things. It's a continuation.
Yeah.
Okay, is the essence of a poem to be understood emotionally or intellectually?
Oh, for me it's emotionally, absolutely. I'm a completely intuitive writer and a completely intuitive reader. And I love when I encounter a poem that I have to say I have no idea what the hell it means, but wow, I really understand it, like in my gut. And those are the poems that I take with me and never forget. The ones that I can read and I intellectually get and I think, oh, that's clever, and then I forget them. Almost immediately.
So what are some of your favorite writers, poets?
Oh, wow. I have so many.
Is it poems or poets?
Both, I guess. Mm-hmm. My favorite poets would include, gosh, John Donne is fantastic. Love John Donne. He's like a master clockmaker. I really admire that. I try to do the arguments that he does, but my mind wanders. So I forget what point I was trying to make. I'm like, oh, a bird. And then I put that in. Who else? I love Novika Tadic. He's Serbian. Milan Djordjevic, also from Serbia. He's great. Charles Simic is fantastic. Mark Strand. Georg Trakl, a lot of the German expressionists I love. I love them better in German than in English. There are so many Italians. Montale is one of my favorites. Umberto Saba, Salvador Quasimodo. I mean, all of these are hugely important to me.
Okay, here's a really easy one for you, Chris. What does it mean then to be a man?
Oh, wow.
Man. Well, yeah, I mean, something's going on. There's some sort of generational shift that's going on with in terms of roles and parenting. My last two books have been tracing it, not saying anything, just sort of observing it, I think, trying to observe it. So I don't know. I mean, what does it mean to be a man? To me, it means to be like bewildered. I really like that word a lot. I like it more than confused. I like it a lot. And that's one response. I mean, I think that what people call toxic masculinity, when you see it in defensive and violent outbursts, I think it's a response to the same stimulus, but it's a different response than bewilderment. I think these guys, I would hope it, I don't think that was a book about toxic masculinity, but it's a book about a little bit about bewilderment and anxiety.
At what moment, Jay, do you decide to break the rules of form to articulate your poem's meaning? Is that intuitive, or are you
completely? Yeah, it's all intuitive.
Right. What kind of study did you do? I mean, did you read these poems, like John Donne's poems, and take them apart and learn how they were put together, or what exactly did you do to
learn about form?
Yeah, to learn about form. I mean, so it would come intuitively.
Right. Well, when I was in grad school in Iowa, I would sit in my apartment. And I would force myself to write, let's say, lines of iambic pentameter. And I would just do 300 or 400 lines every night. They wouldn't make any sense. They wouldn't have anything to do with each other. I'd just do them again and again. And then I would have a deal with myself that I would graduate to a new meter or a new rhyme or whatever when I could go into the Domino's Pizza and order an entire order in iambic pentameter. Just boom. Which is hard because things like soda, they're not iams, so you know, and Coke is just a one stressed syllable. So that's how I internalize the rhyme and the meter.
Chris, do you think you could have produced the same character authenticity in the throwback special, it would have been a different title, if you were to write a piece about women?
If I were to write a
piece, a book about women rather than men.
And achieve the same...
do you think you could have reproduced the same character authenticity?
Wow.
These are good questions.
That is good. That is good. I mean, the writer part of me that likes a challenge wants to say, yeah, you know, and I think I would handle it with appropriate sensitivity and caution and aware of the many traps. I don't know. I can't. Well, the traps of writing about somebody that's not you, which I think, you know, writers should be able to do, right? It's the imagination, and if you do it poorly, you should be called on it, you know? So I think, it may be that I should stretch myself and try. So let's say it wouldn't be a joke. Do you know what I mean? It wouldn't be like sometimes it's attempted and it's sort of like, oh, it's kind of funny to try this. It wouldn't be, I would enter into it seriously. I don't know if I could pull it off.
So what is your next book? What are you working on now?
It's really in the early stages.
Okay, we won't pry.
It's pretty early.
Uh-huh. And Jay, you said you're working on a new book.
I am. Also, it's pretty early.
All right. The heck with you guys.
Sorry.
What fine writers. What a marvelous way to bring Winter with the Writers 2017 to a spectacular close. Thank you, Jay. Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Lisa Lucas. Thank you, our wonderful audience and our equally wonderful community. Winter with the Writers and the National Book Foundation share the view that national writers, writers with remarkable vision and literary skill, are local. We are pleased to bring these writers each February to our community so they may remind us of the best that literature has to say about ourselves across genre and gender, from the past and into the future, here and all around the globe. See you next year.